Members, good morning. We have formed a quorum and it's also the appointed time. I call to order meeting of the Establishment Subcommittee. We have six items on our agenda for discussion. The administration has submitted paper ECI 2018-1911, an information paper for members, setting out a summary of the changes in directorate establishment approved since 2002 and also impact of the six items on the directorate establishment. May I remind members that if you have a direct or indirect pecuniary interest in any of the items on the agenda today, please declare the nature of the interest involved before you speak on the item under ROP 83AM. May I draw members' attention to ROP number 4084 on voting arrangements or regulations on items where you have a direct pecuniary interest. The first item is EC 2018-1916. The paper proposes to create a permanent post in the Labour Department with immediate effect upon approval by the Finance Committee at Directorate 1 to take up various new tasks in relation to the abolition of the offsetting of severance payment and long service payment with employers' mandatory contributions under the MPF system. On the 21st of November 2017, the administration consulted the Manpower panel of the council. Present this morning, we have Mr. Choi. We have Mr. Casper Choi, Undersecretary for Labour and Welfare, Mr. Carlson Chen, Commissioner for Labour, and Ms. Melody Luke, Assistant Commissioner for Labour. I will give the floor to Dr. Fernando Zheng, Chairman of the panel, to brief us on the deliberations of the Manpower. Since Dr. Zheng is not yet here, I will do so on his behalf. The Manpower panel discussed this paper on the 21st of November 2017. In the course of deliberations, members discussed whether the duties for the new post can be absorbed by Manpower redeployment, the specific duties of the new post, and also the timetable of the administration for the abolition arrangement. Members present, in principle, had no objection to the paper being submitted to the ESC for discussion. Some members urged the administration to implement the offsetting abolition of the offsetting arrangement ASAP upon creation of the new posts. I now give the floor to members for questions. First, each will have 5 minutes in the first round. The first is Mr. Ronick Chen.
Thank you, Chairman. On the creation of a permanent post to deal with the abolition of the offsetting arrangement, I have no objection in principle, but I'd like to know whether the post is not created within the LWB, but in the department, because lots of studies still have to be done, and I don't know why the post is not put in the bureau level for coordination and policy consideration. And I said that you need someone that is experienced enough and with the political equipment to deal with the various contentions involving the abolition proposal. I'd like to know whether you've already got someone in mind to fill the post, and this post is supported by three officers. I'd like to know whether you've already got a team of staff following up on this item, and as soon as the post is created, the three will join the new officer to form a four-member team. And then they said that you expect to complete the scrutiny of the bill within the council. And I'd like to know whether the post will help the consultation, or is it the other way around? You, since the post is created, you committed to passing the passing the legislation, whatever. And then the new post will be, this one will be under an assistant commissioner. For the other, assistant commissioners, they only have one or two officers to oversee. So why can't you subsume this under the employees' rights and benefits? Why is it that this assistant commissioner has to oversee the work of two chief labor officers, and for some others only one or even none? Mr. Choi, thank you. I thank Mr. Chin for agreeing that it's necessary to create new posts because our Labor Department staff are working very hard. In April, we created, we convened a preparatory meeting, and then two senior labor officers were involved. Now, if the paper is passed today, it will take immediate effect. We need someone to start work at once, and the workload is very heavy. Amendment of a number of legislations, such as the MPF ordinance and employment ordinance, just to name two, and the work is very controversial. We have to work out the details. Now, that is the preparatory stage. We have to go to LegCo and LAB and some employers' organization. We have a number of meetings a week to explain to different stakeholders, and within the administration, there should be communication and coordination with other departments. We have trustees, and we have to liaise with the DOJ to work out the legislative details of the meetings, and also to prepare meeting papers for information papers for the council. And also the DAS, designated saving accounts and details, these are just at the preparatory stage. Mr. Chen asked whether the post can be created after the legislation is amended, but our workload will not allow us to do that. If you take a look at enclosure 2 of the paper, you can see the duties, responsibilities of the CLO. I had a meeting yesterday, and some members said that the officers of the LD are very hardworking. I've checked with my colleagues. I don't want them to work through weekends. For my people like myself, I don't care. I don't mind. I am prepared for that. But I don't. I wouldn't want to see my colleagues working so hard. And I'd like to see if my colleagues have anything to say. Although the time is up, but then I don't mind giving you a few more minutes. Thank you. Well, the relationship between the Labor Department and the SLB, in fact, the two merged. So Mr. Chen asked why we don't put a new post in the bureau. In fact, this is not really significant, because the bureau or the department has been formulating policies. We're not like other bureaus. For instance, in some of the bureaus, administrative officers may be responsible for drafting the legislation. For us, it's different. This post has to be in the Labor Department because he has to be responsible for policy implementation or formulation and legislative works and so forth. And he has to deal with the setting up of DAS. We have a 25-year two-tier subsidy arrangement, and we rely on the future officer to carry out all these for us. As regards the organization of the Labor Department, we have the five assistant commissioners under the Labor Administration, but there are only two chief labor officers. The organization or the structure of the Labor Administration is such that it's not really very desirable. We have more assistant commissioners than chief labor officers. But that doesn't mean that the proposed new post of CLO can be put under any of the five assistant commissioners, because he has to be under the labor relations division, because the issues he has to deal with will impact on labor relations. For instance, Mr. Chen asked why can't it he be put under employees' rights and benefits division, because the work of this division is quite unique. It has to deal with claims for injuries at work. I'm afraid you have to be more succinct, because I have to save time for other members. Although I allowed you to speak longer, but I have to keep time. Mr. Yu Siwing, 5 minutes. Thank you. Abolition of the offsetting arrangement is an outcome of discussions and consensus between the labor and employer sectors. The business sector has the overall interest of the community in mind, and we support the proposal. In fact, the proposals from the administration and the business sector are quite big, and the administration has not addressed the concerns of the business sector yet. For instance, the business sector has proposed a capital pool, and I think it is desirable. For the administration's proposal, they've told us what are the merits, and I don't know whether the administration can compare its own proposals with the proposal of setting up a capital pool proposed by the business sector. The government's proposal is rather complicated, and the capital pool proposal is relatively simple. The administration has to tell us the merits of its proposal. You have to give us a comparison to let people understand better, because the business sector has a lot of concerns. For instance, 15% of the annual income, that's fine. Now, if there are only three employees, 15% of the annual income, now, should there be a severance or long service payment arrangements? Well, the government will make up for the shortfall, and what if all three have to be dealt with at the same time? And what if SMEs cannot afford the financial burden and becomes bankrupt? And the administration talks about the unfairness to large enterprises using the capital pool. I think there is some problem with this explanation. Well, even in our taxation policy, we tax the large enterprises more to subsidize the disadvantaged in society. So we should set a big capital pool, and then there should be 1% contribution from the employers, and then everything will be dealt with by means of the capital pool. I think this will be more acceptable to SMEs. If by using a DAS, DSAs, the SMEs may find it difficult to understand, and this 15%, well, you cannot really address the concerns of SMEs.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you. Deputy Secretary, the SME would like to have a capital pool. Why wouldn't you consider it? Thank you. Let me just go back to the previous discussions. In the last administration, there was a proposal with an injection of $7.9 billion. It was not accepted. And this proposal entails $17.2 billion, substantial increase. When we discussed with the SMEs, we understood their concerns. So for the current proposal, you will see that we focus on assisting micro establishments, and that is why there would be increased government commitments in the second tier subsidy to help SMEs and micro establishments in the transitioning to the offsetting abolition of the offsetting arrangement. In fact, in the past year, especially over the past week, when we liaised with the employers, they have told us the point, and that is the difference between different proposals, different options, and perhaps I would spare this discussion now. It only explains that in the future there is even a greater need to create this post, because we need to do our preparation, we need to liaise with different stakeholders, and at the moment some employers are still unclear about our proposal. So we need to step up liaison. But of course, Secretary already explained the proposal on his blog. But basically, I agree with Mr. Yu Siwing that we need to step up liaison. And that is why we'd like the funding application to be approved as soon as possible. Next, Mr. Pun Siuping. 5 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. Yesterday, there was a public hearing. Many employers objected to your arrangement. You were criticized for cheating employers and making wrong calculations, but I do understand the government's commitment in dealing with the issue. I think that the offsetting arrangement should be abolished as soon as possible, and I am supportive of any proposal to increase manpower. But I'd like to take this opportunity to ask a few more questions. Like Mr. Ronick Chen asked just now, you have a number of chief labor officers in your establishment at the moment. One is on statutory minimum wage, the other is on working hours policy. The question is, we do not have legislation on working hours. There is only a set of guidelines. Since you're not considering legislating on working hours, why don't you redeploy this chief labor officer? Now, my question is on paragraph 9 of the paper. For the preparatory team, you further envisage that the manpower need to be substantially enhanced for the effective administration of the government subsidy scheme, monitoring the operation of employers, DSAs, etc. So I envisage that the workload will increase substantially, because for the low-income family allowance, you also substantially increased manpower. Now, you will be doing a lot of calculations. So at the moment, you have one chief labor officer leading two staff members to do the work. And what is your estimation of increase in manpower in the future? The other point is that for the chief labor officer overseeing working hours policy, will he be redeployed so as to more effectively deploy your resources? Deputy Secretary, Undersecretary. Yes, thank you for the question. We do have a lot on our plate in terms of maternity leave, employees suffering from injury at work, and other areas, as we explained. After creation of the post, including this post of Chief Labour Officer. There will be a lot of work to do, including preparatory work and also a five-year review. And there would be a formulation of policy on monitoring the implementation of the policy. So there is really a lot to do. And after abolishing the offsetting mechanism, there may be more complex cases regarding labour relations. Well, the member mentioned working hours policy. At the moment, this team is not having a standstill, because after putting forward the proposal, although we decided not to go ahead with legislation as queried by many members, we have been preparing a set of guidelines, and it's not really a clear-cut set of guidelines. We need to draft a set of guidelines for the 11 industries. Well, we have been criticizing you that one set is really toothless, the other is the problem with having two sets of different guidelines for staff members working at for different hours. So you really need to review the legislation as well as the manpower resources. As I mentioned just now, we do have this team here with a lot of work, and we're heading in the direction as I explained. As far as the existing establishment is concerned, there is no room for the CLO to be redeployed. As I mentioned just now, there is already a very heavy workload. There is a need, therefore, to create this post. Have you assessed by substantial increase in manpower, how much are you talking about? Would it be several hundred more posts? Well, if necessary, depending on the circumstances, we will report to the subcommittee. Labour Department, any supplement? In terms of the details of implementation, we need to deal with a number of major issues. For example, setting up the designated saving accounts for employers. And second, we do have a two-tier subsidy mechanism. We need to iron out the details, and we need this proposed Chief Labour Officer to formulate the framework and finalize the details so that we have a better idea in the future the actual manpower needed when the arrangement is implemented. But as pointed out by other members, comparing to other subsidy programs, we do need more manpower to deal with the work. So that means you can't give an estimate of the manpower needed at the moment. Next, Mr. Felix Chung, 5 minutes. Well, as we have heard in yesterday's public hearing, basically, deputations and representatives of the business community have great reservations and doubts on the government's proposed arrangement. The government is forcing the business community to accept this proposal of abolishing the offsetting mechanism. Let me say, you see, we mentioned yesterday, in fact, there was a consensus among the deputations, and that is to have a capital pool option. I don't think there will be a lot of controversies between the labour sector and employers. And yet the government decides to go ahead with its own proposal. And that is the root of disputes and controversies. So why don't you instead accept the proposal already agreed by both employers and the labour sector? Maybe you can compare and contrast and find out the pros and cons of the two proposals. Like Secretary always says, there is no perfect solution, but we can still compare their pros and cons. However, the government just turns us away and decides to go ahead with its own. Then if you adopt the same attitude and say, just create the post and spare the discussion of anything else, that really won't do. I'd like the government to respond. This is something that is acceptable by both the business sector and the labour sector. Why doesn't the government compare and contrast the two proposals? Right, thank you, Chairman. And I heard Mr. Jones' remarks, and I previously also noticed his comment and that we share the same goal in abolishing the offsetting arrangements. What we cannot agree on is the details. Well, in fact, we said throughout the public hearing yesterday, and I understand a lot of employers mentioned that they find the current proposal put forward by the government complex and they don't quite understand. I agree with Mr. Felix Chung. When it comes to details, well, if I am to explain every detail, it will take at least 45 minutes. So in the future, as I mentioned to just now, and as Mr. Yu Siwing said, we may need to work harder on explaining the proposal so that different stakeholders would better understand the pros and cons of different proposals. And Mr. Felix Chung also agreed, as he put it just now, that no proposal is perfect. Now, about the capital pool option, I must say that not everyone in the business community agrees. There are divergent views in the business sector. So there is not unanimous support for the proposal of having a capital pool. And Mr. Jung just now mentioned that for employers who don't understand, we should compare and contrast the different proposals. This is exactly what we are minded to do. By creating this post, we can coordinate work between different government departments, and there is a lot of preparation to do. But at the moment, we do not have the capacity to take up the future increase in workload, and without this proposed post, it will be even harder for us. I know today's discussion is not about whether the government's proposal should be accepted. I think we can all agree that on the one hand, we should go along in this direction, and on the other hand, alleviate the burden of our staff members in the Labour Department. Well, just now in the opening remarks, Undersecretary agrees that abolishing the offsetting arrangement is complex, and there is a lot to do, and this is such a political and controversial issue. Do you think it can be handled by a chief labor officer alone? Not even the secretary can handle it on his own. The secretary has spent half a year explaining to the labor sector and the business sector. So I think if you want to create more posts, instead of having this ordinary low-rank chief labor officer, you should create a post in the bureau. Well, I urge members to support us in this in creating this post. Next, Mr. Tony Chair, 5 minutes.
Thank you, Chairman. I think most people would agree that the MPF offsetting arrangement should be abolished. So this is the right direction. As Undersecretary mentioned just now, assuming that the legislation can be passed, there will be a lot of work. So that's the first point. Second point, well, at the moment, I have this impression that the Labour Department is actually neglecting MPF. There is nobody in charge of MPF, and that explains the public grievances. So with more work, it is only right that you create more posts and increase manpower. But after reading the paper and after listening to the department's explanation, I have the feeling that this work is not permanent. Well, after enacting legislation, you need to do more work. I mean, in the course, you need to draw up the bill and prepare papers.
So why are you asking for a permanent post instead of a supernumerary post? Because once these tasks are completed, they're gone. Well, what about work not completed? Does it mean that there will be a reduction of manpower?
So where are the officers overseeing the operation of MPFS? I do not see any explanation in this paper. And what if the relevant legislation is not passed? What will happen to this permanent post? Chairman, if you look at the duties and responsibilities of the CLO, many of the duties are related to the abolition of the MPF abolition arrangement. They are not long-term. Of course, once the legislation has passed, follow-up work has to be done. Some of the duties here, take number 6 as example, full-scale, to launch full-scale publicity programs. I think that will be done a little bit before the passage of the bill, and then afterwards, just some in a relaxed manner. And what about some amendments to the MPFS? Chairman, I see no reason to support the creation of this permanent post. Undersecretary. Thank you. The abolition work is led by the Secretary for Labour and Welfare, and we set up a working group to take up this task in last April. Now, the preparatory work for the abolition is very complex. We have to communicate with parties within and without the government. And even if the passages, the legislation is passed, the workload is not going to decrease. We have promised a 5-year review after the implementation, and the work has to be led by an experienced officer. Now, if the bill is passed, we have to formulate the strategies, implementation details, and to deal with possible labor disputes. We need a dedicated team of officers to follow up. So we envisage that our workload will be increased substantially, and after the passage of the bill, the workload will only increase further. And I've checked with our current colleagues, their workload is too heavy now already, and we cannot tackle the work by redeployment of manpower. Well, can they list out the duties and responsibilities here to see which duties are going to be permanent ones? And they said that there is no one within the department to look after MPF matters. Commissioner, the enforcement of the MPF-related legislation is not done by the LWB or the LD, it is by the FSTB. All right. So now MPF related issues is entirely neglected by your department now. In future, you will have to take up all the details. No, the MPF authority is responsible for the operation of MPFS, and the regulation is done by FSTB. That means after passage of the legislation, the MPFS authority can cease operation. Now, the workload is also very heavy. Now, we have to communicate with the MPFS authority as well. And in future, the workload of different bureaus will only increase. Can you tell us the distribution of labor among the different bureaus after the passage of the legislation? Because you've only told us part of the picture. Now, your time is up, so I think the Undersecretary has to be very succinct. No, I expect a written reply. All right, then provide a written reply, please. Thank you.
Mr. Ho Kai-ming, 5 minutes, please. Now, this is the ESC. I don't think we should deal with policy matters. We should focus our discussion on post-creation related issues. When it comes to policy issues, I think, Chairman, you have to make a judgment. And I share Mr. Felix Chung's view. I think we should create a very senior position to tackle the abolition arrangement because we want the post to deal with the abolition arrangement ASAP. Many employers don't know what is happening because usually it is the Human Resources Department that looks after such matters. Now, for the employees, our request is very humble. We want to get LSP and LSP that are due to us. We are not receiving anything extra. Many employers don't understand such matters because it is normally the HR department's business. Now, yesterday we had a public hearing and many employers and representatives from the business sector told us that they were not too clear about the details. And even this morning, many colleagues said that they did not understand what the details were and they didn't know how to do the calculation. So I think we should have someone to explain the details to employers better. For instance, you can prepare an Excel template or a calculator so that employers know how to do the calculation. I think the CLO and his team should iron out all these details, so the employers who are not conversant with HR matters will understand how much they will have to pay under the new arrangement and also the level of subsidy they can get. Of course, this is not a regular duty. However, we have to understand that the period will straddle 25 years. Now, and if the government is willing to create a supernumerary post with a time span of 25 years, I don't mind. Otherwise, it is more appropriate to have a permanent post. All right, 5 years down the road, according to the paper, the administration will review the subsidy method of the abolition arrangement. So I'd like to know whether the government is going to revise its level of subsidy and what will the CLO do? Can you tell us exactly what his duties will be? Thank you. Mr. Ho talked about having a template or a calculator. I think these are excellent ideas, and we will consider that. And there are employers who don't understand the details very well, and we will enhance communication with professional accountants and also employers. The review that will be conducted 5 years after implementation. Well, for all policies, we need regular reviews to see whether the implementation is smooth and whether there are any problems. And it also depends on the transitional arrangement and also implementation details, and we'll review whether we can further enhance or improve the operation. Commissioner, regarding the five-year review, we've explained in the paper and on various occasions that we will review the operation of the subsidy arrangements. Whether there will be any further amendments, I think we are just feeling our way forward. We are working on a 25-year scheme, and this is a big challenge to the Labor Department because traditionally the department is an enforcement department, and we act as mediators. We don't have a lot of experience in dealing with such matters. The caseload can be very heavy. Every year, there are about 50,000 cases requiring the offsetting arrangements. There are companies that do not use the offsetting arrangement now, and with the subsidy introduced, they may come and apply for subsidies. So we expect that the caseload can be over 50,000 per year in the future. So in the first 5 years, we'll see whether there are any problems with the actual arrangements, and we'll consider the employers' views on the arrangements and the pace the subsidy is provided. Well, as the chairman, I have to remind members that I will try to be generous when allowing members to ask questions, because the creation of this post is actually related to the abolition proposal. So I will tend to be generous. Thank you. Mr. Wong Ting Kwong.
Thank you, Chairman. The abolition proposal is really a major policy change. It cannot be addressed by means of administrative measures. So I'm of the view that the OD is a department to execute policies. It is not responsible for policy consideration, and therefore the post should be under the Bureau. I think it is open to discussion as to whether it is appropriate to put this post in the department, not the Bureau. Now, for the abolition arrangement for large enterprises, listed companies, and also the big corporations, they are not going to be greatly affected. But for SMEs, it's a matter of life or death for them. Now, if SMEs face financial crisis, if they don't have enough business, they're about to close down, and then the arrangement can be the final straw, can be the last straw. So, Undersecretary, please tell us whether this post to be created will be responsible for implementing the so-called ultimate proposal.
Well, yes, we are moving towards the direction we have proposed. If we keep backpedaling, then we can never move forward. As Mr. Wong said, many employers are concerned about the impact of the abolition proposal on their future, and therefore we have enhanced our subsidy and our period of subsidy for the SMEs. Thank you. Mr. Wong Ting Kwong, I beg to differ from your view. You have never addressed their concerns. Rather, you have refused to consider their concerns. If the government is adamant that the proposal will be implemented as it is now without any adjustment, you can expect strong opposition from the business sector. Well, the business sector rarely take to the streets or organize rallies. Do you want us to do that? We are legislating not for the present. We are doing so for the future. It's not that the business sector rejects or disagrees to your
abolition proposal. Rather, they object to your current proposal. You have to understand this. What you are proposing will have an impact on the interests of both the business, I mean the employer and employees, and this will have profound impact on labor relations. Why should the administration disregard or upset all these interests and relations?
I think the government should really think about it. As a member of the pro-establishment camp, we always support the government in its governance. But on this issue, my stance is clear. I urge the government to think carefully. Undersecretary, Mr. Wong's comments are noted, and we also attach importance to his suggestions in the future. We should step up liaison, as said, and we need to compare and contrast different proposals, and this is also our priority in future. Thank you. Well, you should follow this, the established policy in creating the post. Don't backpedal. If you create the post for this purpose, I don't know whether I have enough votes to block you, but definitely I am going to object. Well, in short, we do have a heavy case load. Regardless of the ultimate proposal, there is a need to create this post in the future. Undersecretary, I want you to clarify this. I want you to clarify whether you meant what I think you mean. The post is not created for the purpose of implementing the final proposal. We create this post to implement the abolition of the offsetting arrangement. Mr. Wu Chiwai, 5 minutes. I get more and more confused after listening to your discussion. From the paper and from the Commissioner and Undersecretary's response, I understand that this post holder will be overseeing the 25-year subsidy proposal. Because of the relatively long period of work, you decided that you should go for a permanent post instead of a supernumerary post. But just now, when you answered Mr. Wong Ting Kwong's question, you mentioned that, in fact, this is not the case. There are other possibilities. Well, in fact, for the Democrats and other members, we have had ample discussions and our attitude is clear. We're heading entirely in the right direction to abolish the MPF offsetting arrangement. And even the member representing the business sector made it clear that the business sector will not object to the objective of abolishing the MPF offsetting arrangement. The question is what proposal we should go for to make sure that Hong Kong people, including the business community's interests, are safeguarded without having a significant impact. Having heard the discussion for so long, my understanding is that according to the administration, the 25-year subsidy program is the only acceptable proposal, and on this basis, you are proposing to create this post. As I mentioned before, and it is also clearly set out in the paper, at this stage, this colleague may need to give a lot of support in other areas. Before we finalize the proposal, you should not come and ask for a permanent post. I think this is running contrary to the government's principle in creating posts. Let's say if you apply for a supernumerary post limited to 5 years for the purpose, there won't be so many objections. Now you're asking for a permanent post, and that means no matter the outcome, this post will continue to exist in the future, and this is why I find it unreasonable, as mentioned by the commissioner. The other point is that in terms of the day-to-day supervision and the disbursement of funds, it will come under the MPF authority. It is not actually under the ambit of the Labour Department. The Labour Department's responsibility is to deal with possible labour disputes. So if there is indeed a surge in caseload, you need to tell us the final proposal and explain what possible labour disputes there will be in the future. Or perhaps to tell us whether the Labour Department will have the final adjudication or whether it lies with the MPFA. These are all unknowns, and now you're asking for a permanent post as if we already have a final proposal. And I think you're trying to do it out of expediency to create a post on the basis that we only agree on the objective of abolishing the MPF offsetting mechanism. So, Undersecretary, my question here is whether you will turn this permanent post into a time-limited supernumerary post for a period of, say, 5, 7, or 10 years. I won't have objection in that case. In fact, the bill will be tabled before 2020, and you estimate that it won't be implemented until much later, and we're in 2018. If you apply for funding to create a permanent post, with everything unknown at the moment, I think it is not a good use of public money. Undersecretary, thank you, Chairman, and thank you, Member. Just now, we already explained the work of the Chief Labour Officer, including the preparatory work, the degree of complexity and the time needed. It will take a long time. And even the member said that, well, that's why you can ask for extension of the 5-year supernumerary post. I won't have any objection. We also need to take into account the fact that once the proposal is passed in the future, we need to conduct a review. We need to monitor its implementation and also deal with possible labour disputes. There is a lot to do. Regardless of what the proposal is, the simple answer is definitely there will be an increase in workload. So to answer members' question, in short, I don't think a supernumerary post can or temporary post can deal with the workload mentioned. It's a supernumerary post, not a temporary post. Mr. Ray Chan, 5 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. I think for this general objective of abolishing the MPF offsetting mechanism, it is supported by the council across different political parties, even the business sector. But this is a brand new policy, and it also touches on the implementation of a new policy. I don't agree that as the establishment subcommittee, we should not ask about policy issues. And I subscribe to your view that we should implement this policy as soon as possible so that the MPF offsetting arrangement can be abolished. And I'm all for that. But I really cannot agree on this note that if I agree with the general principle, I can just ignore everything else as long as there are enough votes. This should not be allowed, Chairman. I think that we need to agree on the policy and the proposal in general, and we need to build trust before I agree to the funding approval. Now, about the work involved from A to H is really wide in scope. From the discussion, negotiation, to legislation, operation after its implementation, and a review after 5 years. I think a lot of members already asked this question. One reason why we question whether a supernumerary post should be created instead is that we question if these should be done by only one officer. or whether it should be dealt with by other officers under the financial services portfolio. The government also conducted a briefing session with us to explain to us. Mr. Felix Chung also held another briefing session. At the same time, whilst I understood the government's proposal, I also understood Mr. Chung's concerns. Meanwhile, you suggest that the post be created as soon as possible. Do you even have a legislative timetable? Is it that before 2020, the end of this term, this can be done? Or are we just talking about preparation work within this term and that the bill will not be tabled until next term? Because it's a matter of complexity here. Some members suggest you should have a 3-year time-limited supernumerary post instead, because afterwards you can ask for even more posts. At the moment, some members aren't very clear, or they don't think that the government's proposal is the best one, and they have reservations over this post. If you ask for a supernumerary post for the preparatory work, do you think that there will be less objection? Well, we'd like to speed things up as well, but drawing on the experience on legislating on paternity or maternity leave, we are concerned that there won't be sufficient time to complete the work before the end of the term in 2020. Well, we'd like to speed things up, but that means more manpower. At the moment, the timetable is that in 2020, after the recess, we can table the bill. It is quite a controversial bill, as you would agree. In terms of the details of implementation and system upgrade, we need to do the preparatory work, and we'd like to respond to the members' remarks that we are proposing to create a permanent post because continuity is important. From preparation to passage of the bill to implementation, we need continuity to do the work properly, including the drafting of the bill and implementation. Other details are set out in the paper. I just urge members to support us. Let me just respond that even if the administration is suggesting that the bill won't be passed until, say, 2 years of discussion after change of term in 2020, I really question whether it's suitable to create a permanent post, or would it be more reasonable to suggest a transitional post of 3 years? Continuity is important. We need a permanent post. As for the progress, it really depends on the electrical arrangement and the time for discussion. Many members have asked questions for the first round. We have a number of members waiting to ask questions in the second round. Mr. Felix Chung, 4 minutes, second round. Thank you, Chairman.
聽到很多建制派議員都有那個,
I think that there are doubts in the minds of many members. They ask questions, but I don't think the administration replied to them. Well, about allocation of work, and also Mr. Wanting Kwong asked about policy issues. If we don't ascertain these things, we are really unsure what this post will cover. From discussion to legislation, implementation, supervision, it seems that everything will be taken up by this single post. I really can't believe it. If you don't explain the policy matters to us, clearly it's really difficult for us to support you today. And now I seem to understand that there is a consensus on why we need a permanent post instead of a time-limited supernumerary post. In fact, you can create a supernumerary post of 3, 5, or even 7 years. If it is very controversial, you can then create this temporary post and then change it to a permanent one.
And yet, today you're asking for a permanent post. We are not aware of his scope of work, and so it's a bit hard. Although some members ask for paper on the division of labor of among bureaus and departments, I won't accept that. I will have to read the paper first, and if it is acceptable, then I will reconsider it. So let me see the paper first, and then we can come to discuss whether this post should be created under Secretary. In fact, the duties and responsibilities can be found in the paper. I have no more to add. Well, then the Secretary adopts such an attitude. He will say no to this and that. Well, I myself can delay you for 6 hours. You can't expect to create it within this year. So I don't mind sitting here and discuss with you for 6 hours. I can take up 3 ESC meetings. So you go back and give me a proper answer. Undersecretary, any supplementary information? I defer to the Commissioner. Commissioner for Labour, please. Mr. Jung said that the post will have a very wide portfolio and whether it is really feasible. In fact, we have the Labour Department and the Bureau are merged. Well, many of my colleagues are responsible for drafting of legislation, implementation and enforcement. So one officer has to take up a full range of tasks. So I think this is not just unique to our department. I think in many bureaus, there may be colleagues who have to deal with not just implementation and enforcement. They may have to be involved in policy formulation and drafting as well. And I think this is a big challenge. And that's why we're asking for CLO post. So we believe it is appropriate. All right, Mr. Longwai Kwok, first round, 5 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. A member said that the business sector supported the abolition arrangement. I have to point out that this is not true. Yes, the business sector knows that the administration insists on abolishing the offsetting arrangement. And we understand that it's unavoidable that the proposal will be passed in this council and is a reality. I think this will better explain the current situation. Yes, Mr. Phyllis Jung is nodding his head, and even Mr. Wong Ting Kwong is nodding his head at the back. So I must point out this very unfair and situation. All of a sudden, the administration thinks that it was wrong in the past. It has gone back on its promise given to the community back then. The government then undertook and explained to the then Legislative Council why there should be an offsetting arrangement in the MPF system. You may revert to the Hansard. Main officials said that the offsetting arrangement was not
introduced by means of the MPF system. Rather, it was always there in the employment ordinance because the administration wanted to encourage different organizations to set up MPF funds. The government encouraged employers and employees to put money into a piggy bank so that should there be any severance or dismissal or retirement, there would be money to safeguard the interests of employees. And so the offsetting arrangement was only carried through in the MPF system. I have said this once. If I've said it once, I've said it a number of times in this council. So finally, the administration has heeded the views of the business sector. Finally, in the transitional period, the government has enhanced its support to SMEs by means of a two-tier subsidy system, and it has also extended the subsidy period. It is willing to provide more resources to help SMEs. So this situation is clear. But only the two figures are clear. When it comes to implementation, the situation is very vague. What enterprises, what are the enterprises that can benefit from the subsidy is still unknown. So you want to create a post today. What is the post for? As pointed out by many members, now we're not really backpedaling to the policy level. But I think such details should be explained to us because we're not talking about the policy per se. We are asking what this post is going to do. So a number of members have asked questions to no avail. I have got to steal 1 more minute for the administration to respond. Well, many members have asked the same question, but I don't find the answers satisfactory. Administration, do you have further explanation? As mentioned in the paper, now for those present at the public hearing yesterday, you would see that many members from the business sector and the community still have misunderstandings and uncertainties about the new arrangement. So when it comes to preparation, we have to approach different stakeholders, including business associations and also the stakeholders. So this new officer will have to lead a team of staff to do the preparation work. So that's a simple reply, and if need be, I can continue to answer related questions. Dr. K.K. Kwok, first round, Chairman. Well, two points were expressed at yesterday's public hearing very clearly. Many labor groups are of the view that the government owes them a lot because of the offsetting arrangements. Every year, billions of dollars were lost, and the business sector keeps opposing the abolition arrangement. My position is very clear. I want the abolition arrangement to be put in place ASAP because the government has owed the labor sector for many years. And the government has been increasing its commitment to $29.3 billion. At first, it was only a little bit more than $10 billion. Now, the commitment is almost double. So will the administration continue to refine the proposal? That means will the government keep increasing its financial commitments? This is in fact the concern of many deputations present yesterday. Because to be fair, the government should have introduced universal retirement protection, but it's pointless to dwell on this point. My concern is how you are going to go forward. Many people from the business sector against your proposal. In fact, over 90% of them are from your governance alliance. So I don't know what's the chance of success. And the other proposal is to withdraw the current proposal and start a new discussion. But that may mean many years of procrastination. Now, if we want something to be introduced in 2020, I'm a bit worried looking at the current progress. Of course, I will not oppose the government's implementation or of the abolition proposal. But the point is, how are you going to convince the business sector? The labor sector is awaiting the implementation of the proposal, and I doubt whether this post can achieve your purpose. My worry is, even with the post created, the matter is still unsettled. So this is not good from an HR point of view. So will you first seek the agreement of the business sector first? Now, I of course, I'm not supporting the business sector's stance, but I just want to know what the government is going to do. Under Secretary, the government is committed to abolishing the offsetting arrangement, but the challenges are rather hard to overcome. And as we all know, there is no perfect solution to the matter. In yesterday's public hearing, many employers asked questions in relation to the calculation and the relative pros and cons of the proposal vis-a-vis other proposals. So there is a lot of work waiting to be done before we can take forward our proposal. As set out in the paper, the work is long-term, it's complex, and a lot of departments and manpower is involved. We have to boost our manpower support in order to take forward the proposal. So the Labor Department has already got a very heavy workload, and we want a post to be created in the department to address the very complex work we have in front of us in order to take forward the proposal. Does that mean that you will insist on the current proposal? And secondly, if unfortunately your proposal failed, then that would render the post meaningless. Well, the proposal was only announced in October, and we need time to explain to different stakeholders. We are very determined. Thank you. Mr. Jeremy Tam, 5 minutes. Well, the Civic Party supports the abolition of the offsetting arrangement, and we want it to be implemented ASAP. But then this post is a permanent one. According to the Undersecretary, the post is created for the abolition proposal. Usually, the government will first create a 3-year supernumerary post and then extend it for a number of times before making it a permanent post. So can you explain to us why you start off with a permanent post and not a supernumerary one? As Dr. KK Kwok said, well, if your exercise is abortive, what are you going to do with this permanent post? All right, transitional arrangements.
Members may note that in terms of the abolition of the offsetting arrangement, the preparatory work is substantial and complex, And it's difficult to say in terms of time frame whether we can complete the work in 3 years. Continuity is important. Not to mention other work, other areas such as monitoring, implementation, review after the bill is passed. So if it is a time-limited post, the postholder may not be able to deal with all the work involved. The best solution, therefore, is to create a permanent post, as I explained just now, because of continuity and the time needed. We therefore propose a permanent post. I find it problematic, Chairman, because in the past, we see a lot of civil service posts initially being created as a time-limited supernumerary post that are later converted into permanent posts. Continuity isn't an issue. Even for the civil aid department, civil aviation department, there's an assistant director post that have remained a 3-year time-limited supernumerary post instead of permanent one. So even if there is a question on continuity, we do see circumstances in which the post is first created as a time-limited post before it's converted into a permanent post. Well, when we still have question marks about this proposal, I want to know why this case is so special. Because for other civil service posts, there is also the importance of continuity. So why permanent posts for this one, Commissioner? Let me just supplement that for the abolition of MPF offsetting arrangement, it is not a time-limited one-off situation. In fact, from the last administration to the current one, to future administrations, I believe we'll be heading in the same direction. It takes several years for preparation and enactment of legislation. After the offsetting arrangement is abolished, we still need to, well, Chairman, may I just interject that I do not agree with him. That would be the case for every post. Why is it that this post is so special, especially when you are not sure whether the policy or the bill will be passed? Usually, after a bill is passed, there will be a surge in caseload, and very often, the administration would only submit a funding application for more posts after the bill is passed. But let's not dwell on that. Ultimately, we need the government's commitment of $29.3 billion, and that we can have the abolition of offsetting arrangement for employees without significant impact on the business community. I don't think the public cares much about the details. It has to be simple, however. Just like our simple tax regime, as the chief executive puts it all the time, one of the advantages of our economy is that we have a simple tax regime. Now, when we take a look at this table, it's really complex. Just ask anyone who has heard your explanation whether they could give they could recount what it means. Even for SMEs, they may need several hours to absorb what you explain. All right, this is understood. That is exactly why we need to create this post. We need to explain the policy to the stakeholders. Next, Mr. Martin, you have 5 minutes. It's a matter of principle that I'd like to make clear. Around the world, in every country, in every place, retirement protection isn't solely the responsibility of employers. What we're hearing now is that the business sector in general does not object to the offsetting arrangement being abolished. I don't think even Mr. Felix Chong is suggesting that. He represents the business sector. The question is about abolition of the offsetting arrangement, whether we can enhance the proposal to alleviate the burden on SMEs. The proposal is controversial, and we have yet to reach a final proposal. Now, on the premise of abolishing the offsetting arrangement, I think for this proposal to create a post, it is at the moment neutral. And I understand the government is still negotiating with different stakeholders. So my question is, if the proposal isn't yet final, why do you need to create this permanent post at this stage? Undersecretary, thank you for the question. We need to create a post now because regarding our work of abolishing the offsetting arrangement from the last administration to March this year or to October this year, when we have the new enhanced proposal, it is put forward to allay the concerns of SMEs and micro-establishments. So under the enhanced proposal, we have lengthened the period of the second tier with more commitment. In fact, after the enhanced proposal was rolled out in October, what we need to do is to step up liaison with stakeholders. In fact, as you can see from yesterday's experience, employers as well as employees have misunderstandings of the current proposal. So we need to do more in terms of explanation. And like other members mentioned just now, we need to compare and contrast different proposals, and that requires manpower. At the moment, the Labour Department doesn't have capacity to step up work in this regard. And if we are to properly implement abolition of the offsetting arrangement, we need to explain, first of all, that last month, October, we put forward a proposal, and we need to explain that to different stakeholders. And Mr. Ho also mentioned the calculator. And these are all things we need to do as we proceed with the abolition of offsetting arrangement. And we also set out in a paper that we need to contact different stakeholders, and we need to carry out the legislative amendments. We already have a team of staff. But without more manpower, it is impossible for the Labour Department to take up this additional work. And we therefore appeal to members to support this proposal. I still have time, Chairman. Can I ask two more simple, straightforward questions? First, for the time being, we do not have a final proposal. That's the first point. Take it from me. Second point, this post holder, are you suggesting that we'll be responsible for exploring different options? Undersecretary, let me make it clear that we put forward a proposal in October. It's a new proposal, and we need to explain the proposal first. If we create a post without any proposal at all, it's difficult for members to support this establishment proposal. As for preparatory work and details, there is a lot to work on. And after passage of the bill, we need to conduct a review 5 years after implementation. All right, that's it. I don't think he has answered my question. All right, that means he is unable to give me a clear answer. Noted. Next.
Okay, 好, 下一位, 陳振英議員, 第二輪, 麻煩.
Second round, Mr. Ronick Chan. We've been discussing it the whole morning, and I think members' position is that in terms of the implementation, The Labour Department, there are divergent views. There are also divergent views on whether it should be a permanent or a supernumerary post. And in terms of the rank itself, there are also different views. In the first round, I ask about the problem with the organisation, and my question hasn't been answered. I want to know why this post is a chief labour officer instead of an assistant commissioner. If it is such an important post, if the issues are so complex, why is it just set at the rank of chief labour officer? You haven't explained to me. Well, even if we have this assistant commissioner for labour of very high caliber, why is it that this assistant commissioner would be overseeing two CLOs, whereas two other assistant commissioners would be overseeing one CLO, and two other assistant commissioners will be seeing or will be overseeing no CLOs at all? Well, can you just explain it by way of the heavy workload? Is that the reason that you'll be using for future applications? I find it hard to accept. So why is it that the CLO must come under the Assistant Commissioner for Labour Relations, Ms. Look? I haven't heard a sound explanation. Second point is mentioned by Undersecretary about a capital pool proposal. There is a lack of consensus in the business sector. Well, but I haven't heard any president of the government getting 100% consensus in a particular sector before looking into a particular proposal. So about this CLO, does it mean that consultation will be part of his work? Well, a lot of members already asked whether this CLO will explore the option of a capital pool. We need to compare different proposals. Perhaps the Labour Department can respond to his question on the post. Under different circumstances, at different times, when we need to introduce a new policy, we do not have a crystal ball. But in fact, over the past 2 years, as far as the Assistant Commissioner, Ms. Look, was concerned, she had to deal with a number of new policies, including the abolition of the offsetting arrangement. Well, but of course, within the Labour Department, we can redeploy staff in the light of new developments. At this moment, however, Ms. Look, the Assistant Commissioner, has been following up on the issue for a number of years, since the last administration, when consultation was conducted on retirement protection. Labour Department was also involved, and the Assistant Commissioner, Look, also took up much of his work. The immediate issue we should address is that in terms of the policy of abolishing the offsetting arrangement, we need to formulate the policy on the one hand. We need to formulate the framework, draw up a bill, and implement the details. For example, DSAs for employers and subsidy arrangements. And we need a senior officer to deal with these issues and assist Ms. Look, the Assistant Commissioner. Second round, Mr. Wuchiwa.
樂軒呢?好多主席。我想不如我嘗試從另一個角度。
Thank you. Let me take another perspective. At the moment, which colleague of yours is in charge of abolition of the offsetting arrangement? This colleague carries huge responsibilities, and he'll be dealing with the issue for quite some time, but can you explain your current situation? Or to put it more frankly, if you apply for a permanent post, and then for various reasons, your proposal is voted down, do you have any backup plan to assist Ms. Lok, the Assistant Commissioner, who has been following up on the issue?
Hey, oh.
Undersecretary. The work is being done by the Secretary and supported by the Labour Department. Well, SLO and 2LOs are responsible for the work in a team set up in April. As I said, our colleagues are increasingly overloaded, and if the post is not created, then the work will be delayed. Can you tell us how it's going to be delayed or slowed down? Can you explain to us the current arrangements? Commissioner, as I said, I've only got one assistant commissioner, and her main duty is to deal with the abolition of the offsetting arrangement. Another area of work is extension of maternity leave proposed in the policy address and involves another major subsidy scheme. And also paternity leave is also handled by Ms. Lok, the Assistant Commissioner. And why we want a permanent post? Because we believe that after the abolition of offsetting arrangement, we expect there will be a rise in number of labor disputes related to LSP and SP. Can you explain to us why, with the abolition of offsetting, you expect a rise in the number of labor disputes related to SP and LSP? Well, you have to understand that with the offsetting arrangements in the past two decades, the number of disputes have been rather stable and on the low side, because under the offsetting arrangements, employees understand that if they want SP and LSP, at the end of the day, it would come from their own MPF accounts prematurely. And on average, an employee may have to top up about 16 to 20% of the total payment. Now, I understand that. But this will only happen after the legislation is passed. And it's also emergency work the CLO will have to take on. So our debate is not that we don't agree to your creation of post, but according to our experience with ESC, pending formal implementation of a policy, the government will ask for a supernumerary post. Please don't misunderstand us. We're not saying no to your application for a new post. Rather, we're saying that it should be a supernumerary one instead of a permanent post. Because after the law is passed, we may have to revisit the manpower requirements to implement the legislation, and then you can have a permanent post. And I think you haven't addressed at this point yet. Please be very succinct, because the members' time is up. As we explained, this is long-term work, and therefore we need a permanent post. Because the time frame is very long, we urge members to support a permanent post. Mr. Unlockin, round two, first round, 5 minutes.
Thank you, Chairman. So,
I think the post is created even though the legislative proposals are not finalized. So you may have further adjustments to your proposal, and you may have to conduct another round of study. Will you approach different stakeholders in revising the package or adjusting the package? You know, many members have told you issues that employees may face after the abolition of the offsetting arrangement, for instance, in the issue of continuous service. Some employees will have their SP many employees may have to receive many rounds of SPs because of the issue of continuous contract. So I'd like to know whether will be the duty of the new post to consider the impact of labor relations as a result of the abolition proposal. Well, it's not just the labor sector. In the business sector, we have to approach different organizations to explain to them different scenarios employees may face in the future, and also the possible impact of the future policy. And therefore, we need to create a post to reach out to different stakeholders to explain to them the details. As said in the paper, we will conduct a review 5 years after the abolition. We have said a number of times that there may be labor issues as a result of the abolition. We need a team of staff to tackle such issues. Chairman. Then holder of the post will have to address queries from different stakeholders. You heard the views of the labor and employer sectors yesterday. I hope that this office holder can help to forge a consensus between the two parties. And the policy address has addressed or has adjusted the subsidy arrangements. And I think the government has conceded to the employers because you have another tier and the calculation method is also different now. I hope you have specific measures to address the issues faced by the labor sector. Of course, today is not the time to discuss policy, and I have already mentioned those issues to you. I hope the post can address the very complicated calculation in the future. I hope you can set up a formula or find an user-friendly way to allow people to work out the subsidy during the transitional period, and also where people can see adjudication should there be any arguments over the calculation of such payments. Under Secretary, Mr. Ao asked whether we can have a simple way to explain and show the calculation to the stakeholders. Yes, we will think about that. and both the Bureau and the department staff will help. This is not just the work of this CLO, but we are understaffed to take on so many duties, and therefore we want members to support the paper. Thank you. Mr. Wong Ting Kwong, second round, 4 minutes. Thank you. I've worked in the council for a long time, and of course I understand that in this CU we should discuss the establishment proposals instead of policies. However, this is a big issue, and therefore we have no choice. As shown in yesterday's, well, you said that the business sector did not understand and had a lot of misunderstandings. I think this is an insult to the sector. We have no misunderstandings, and please do not use such terms to attack the sector or the industry. And the administration has doubled, almost doubled the subsidy level, and the subsidy period is extended to 25 years. Now, either you shoot a body, shoot somebody in one go, or you cause him to die painfully after many assaults. So I think it is the latter in this case. You want to create a permanent CLO post under the Labor Department. The Labor Department is an executive department. Without the policy, how can the department execute it? So I suggest, Undersecretary, that you withdraw this paper first and come back with a paper to create a post in the SLB, and I will support it so that you can come up with a package that is acceptable to both the labor and business sectors. Thank you. I already explained earlier, and I heard opposition from the business sector as well. But the government is determined to abolish the offsetting arrangement, and we hope to move towards that direction. I have no doubt about the government's commitment, because it's one of the undertakings of the CE in her election campaign. But make sure that you will not cause endless troubles to SMEs and cause them to go extinct. 25 years down the road, I don't know where the current CE and myself are. Perhaps you will still be around, but the policy is formulated not for the present generation. Rather, we should legislate for the long-term harmonious relations between the employees and employers. Undersecretary. Well, we have made the proposal to cater for the SMEs and micro enterprises. I appreciate Mr. Wong Ting Kwong's concerns, and we have approached the business sectors, and I understand that they have the same reaction. So we will enhance communication to allay the concerns of the business sector. We really hope that members can support our paper, because the workload of the department is too heavy. I still have time. Don't talk about allaying the concerns. You should explain and then drive away their concerns. Do not just allay our concerns, but address and resolve our concerns, because our concerns are very real. Thank you for your encouragement, Mr. Wong. We will do so. Mr. Jeremy Tam, 4 minutes. I ask the secretary to do some calculation, assuming that employee earns $37,000 and he's served the employer for 8 years. What should he get? How many years, Mr. Tam? 8 years. All right. So I'll ask my colleague to. No, you do it. You do it. I can give you time. You have 3 minutes, 30 seconds. Please do the calculation yourself. $120,000. So the employer has to pay him $120,000. All right, that's better. I will go and double check whether it's indeed $120,000. So if you can enable an employer to work out the sum very quickly, then that's all right. But if the method is very complicated and takes the employer a long time to do it, and he may have to do it and redo it, then it's not so good, because employers are not so conversant with such matters. Now, unless you're employing hundreds of officers to help our employers, all right, you told me it was $120,000. Can you tell me how you arrived at that figure? I do understand what you mean. That is how we can very simply address an employer's question. Now, I'm an employer. Was mentioned, we are going to, well, I still have time of close to 2 minutes.
Well, you answered me $37,000 for 8 years. The employer will have to pay $120,000. Explain to me how this is come by. Undersecretary, you didn't do the calculation? All right, please let him ask. Well, then he's cheating. Just now I asked the undersecretary to calculate himself, and then he told us 120,000. That means you know how to calculate the sum. Well, for the details, may I defer to my colleague? Well, I'm not talking about details. Let's be fair. I asked you to do the calculation. You then ask, no, I should ask my colleague to do it. But you're the one who are trying to convince us. If you want to lobby our support, you definitely would know how to calculate. Chairman, I haven't finished. I asked you how much, and then you said you find your colleague to do it, and then you told us 120,000. That means you know how to work out the sum, and you're just such a genius. You could work it out so quickly. I want you to explain to me the steps how you reached 120,000. Undersecretary, please. I have 1 minute. Because you're a math genius, you answered in 30 seconds just now. Let's see which colleague could take your question. So you cheated, Undersecretary. You didn't cheat, did you? Well, it's not cheating. I think we have a division of work, and that is why we need a chief labor officer. We have been in the department for 30 years. Definitely, we could work out the sum faster. I'm not saying the Undersecretary couldn't work out the sum. That's why we're giving him time to work out the sum, to show us, because you need to be fair. If you can't even work out the sum, how can you ask others to work out the sum? You have been in this post for so long. Well, it's not a wrong sum, because Mr. Tam, you mentioned 30,000 something. No, $37,000 for 8 years. Well, when we calculate the SP, LSP is capped at $22,500. So we base our calculation on $22,500 for 8 years in the working out the sum for the LSP and SP. And the total sum for SP and LSP is $120,000 because of the cap. So I understand members would find it complicated. We therefore will prepare a simplified formula. All right, understood, Mr. Wong Ting Kwong. Is so familiar with the subject that I don't know what the right answer should be. Anyway, we really need to go back and consider whether we support the permanent post. Well, your time is up, Mr. Jeremy Tam. Next, Mr. Ho Kai Ming. Second round, 4 minutes. Mr. Jeremy Tam asked a question just to show that not everyone is familiar with labor laws. And I don't want to criticize the administration, but even Jeremy Tam didn't know that in fact when you calculate the SP and LSP, you should base your calculation on the cap of 22,500, and you are in fact an employer yourself because you have a ward office. That means we need we need the administration to do more on publicity, because for these details, one wouldn't know unless one is fired. And then you would know when calculating the SP and LSP, the evil of offsetting arrangement. We have 3 million employees and 7 million different cases. Well, for the FTU, we received some very extreme cases. Under these extreme situations, even after passage of the bill, under the abolition of the offsetting arrangement, employees turn out getting a smaller sum of SP and LSP. We need to work out the details because different employees have different work situations and their LSP and SP may be different. We support this permanent pause because once the arrangement is abolished, I understand to be corrected, that there could be increase in labor disputes. After year 2000, the LSP and SP only come from the other pocket of yourself, whilst the employer only covers 20% of the sum. But once the offsetting arrangement is abolished, the government is going to provide subsidy. So definitely, with a greater sum involved, there will be more and more labor disputes. There are labor disputes at the moment. So I want the administration to say whether the polls can really help address labor disputes. We have two more members who have pressed the button waiting to speak, for other members who would like to speak as well and haven't pressed the button, please keep note of the time because I need to make arrangements. Commissioner, I thank Mr. Ho for his question. I think he has already explained the situation on my behalf. When the arrangement is abolished, that means additional payment will have to be made out by the employers instead of relying on offsetting against the MPF contributions up to 20%. The employers will need to pay extra for the LSP and SP. In the past, there was little incentive to strive for the abolition, because after all, it's a transfer of money from one pocket to another for the payment of LSP and SP. Therefore, in the past, the situation has been quite stable. In particular sectors, however, or outsource contracts, sometimes we see labor disputes over the matter. In the future, however, because of the different interests involved, the labor sector would hope to get the larger amount of LSP and SP, and the contrary would apply to employers, and that would lead to more labor disputes. Well, next, Mr. Alohim. Mr. Ho Kai-ming, let me give you a gentle advice. Don't just always criticize other people for not being familiar with the subject. And I think that we come from different backgrounds and different perspectives, and it's always good to enhance communication. You should not criticize anyone for being ignorant about certain subject. And I must say that I am not familiar with this subject. There may be problems arising from abolishing the arrangement. I don't know how the administration would interpret this. have you looked into the legislative basis? If an employer utilizes the MPF contribution before the line is drawn to offset the LSP and SP after the line is drawn, and there are also the extreme cases as mentioned, that in the end, after the bill is passed, the LSP and SP may be of a smaller amount. Is there any way to plug this loophole? Have you looked into that? Who would take this question? I'll defer to the Commissioner. First question, let's see if I get your question correctly. The proposal at the moment is that after the bill takes effect, after the offsetting arrangement is abolished, employers will be allowed to make use of the employers' MPF contributions to pay for the SP or LSP calculated based on the years of service of the employee. Legally speaking, it is necessary. I'm not asking about necessity. I'm asking whether you have looked into the matter from the legislative perspective, whether it will be clearly stipulated. We'll make it clear that there is no retrospective effect. That is, before the date of abolition, the SP, LSP that an employer is required to pay can be offset against the MPF contributions, because usually the laws don't have retrospective effect, and we'll make it clear in the law. Second point, whether a lot of employers will resort to other means to avoid paying LSP and SP as their responsibility. In fact, there are ways to circumvent their responsibility even before the legislation is passed. For example, for severance payment, we have a year of service requirement, that is 2 years. For LSP, 5 years. As we adopt years of service as the criterion, if the employer is minded to shun this responsibility of paying SP and LSP, then the employer could just fire an employee after 1 year and 11 months of service. But is it done on a massive scale? There is a keen demand for manpower in our workforce. Let's say if an employer signs a contract of 3 years with an employee, is it that easy for an employer to fire an employee a year and a half later and find a replacement? It may not be as easy. The Labour Department does receive complaints, but in the light of the current manpower situation, we don't see this happening with prevalence. Well, we have two more members who would like to ask questions, but we do not have time. I'll adjourn the meeting now. Mr. Felix Chong. Well, some members ask the administration about division of work and compare and contrast different proposals. I want to know whether the administration can give us information in this regard before the next meeting. That's a member's request. Would administration please note his request? That concludes today's meeting. The next meeting will be held on the 5th of December 2018 from 8:30 to 10:30. Thank you.